Amen. Now, concerning idols, it's worth knowing what we're talking about. Yes, for Paul and for the Corinthians, the big question was, in fact, the kind of thing we often assume when we think of the word idol. A figure hewn of human hands, revered, a symbol or vessel of a god, often one to be sacrificed to. In the Greco-Roman world, which Paul is writing in, most meat found in the marketplace had been sacrificed to idols. There were clubs and groups in Corinth who would gather around idols such as these and eat the food of the gods. That was part of being members of such clubs. For that matter, at various times during the early church, a pinch of salt or incense was required to be thrown on an altar to the emperor. And in so doing, the emperor was being affirmed as a god, not a man. All these are examples of idols. But they're not the only examples. Idols are plentiful, as Paul writes. There are many gods and many lords. You see, ultimately, anything can become an idol. Anything we fear, love, and trust that isn't God is a danger of becoming an idol for us. Think for a moment of advertisements. Each one is a 30-second piece constructing an idol. For example, fear. Do you have acne? I bet that's why you're a failure. Buy our product and you will be saved. Love. Do you want a significant other? If you do, buy our particular version of bras and Prince Charming's will be knocking at your door. Trust. What happens if you die? Who will take care of your kids? Who will take care of your family? There's only one life insurance company you can trust in order to be safe. Or if that's a little too silly or alternatively a little too close to home, take a moment. Center yourself. And answer these questions. What gives you a feeling of transcendence, of awe? What are the elements in those moments in your life that are both frightening and exhilarating? What and who do you just deeply love? When your mind wanders onto tracks of joy, where do those tracks end up? To where are you being beckoned? Where, as well, do you find you put your trust? When the stuff hits the fan, where do you duck to? What's bedrock for you? Now, I would venture a guess. I would bet these things aren't all bad. Maybe even most of them are good. A friend or spouse or relative, a radio station, a cup of coffee in the morning, a bank account, a supervisor, a particular vacation spot. By and large, not bad things. But things worth keeping an eye on, worth being aware that, in a pinch, you might pluck them from their proper place as a thing and make them into a god. Luther writes that humans are natural idol makers. We take good things and inflate them with an unnatural power over us. We give them the power, transform a good thing into an idol, call a piece of creation the Creator, we give them that power over us, either individually or collectively. But here's the thing, we don't all have the same idols. There are, of course, some things that are more prevalent than others, ideas and actions and goods and services that whole societies become addicted to. But there are also things that hold different allures to different people. And that's kind of where Paul's interaction with idols today is playing out. There's a group of Christians in Corinth who are well aware that the idols in their town, with meat being sacrificed to them, in fact had no power over the person unless they gave it to them, gave the idol that power. So they ate the meat. They may even have joined some of these eating clubs, knowing that the idols were nothing, in no way a danger to their soul, for their soul belonged to their Lord and Master Jesus Christ. They were liberated from fearing, loving, or trusting those idols. But there was also another group of Christians who were more scrupulous, who still felt a certain affinity towards those idols. They were still scared of them, or found them alluring, or thought they might even be in some way trustworthy. So they avoided any interaction with idols, avoided eating clubs, and certainly avoided pagan temples, and even just eating meat, because they knew that more likely than not, the meat they'd have on their plate had been prepared on another plate, lifted up in honor of an idol, some god or another. And Paul wanted to make sure these two groups of Christians, the ones who saw themselves as liberated from idols, and the ones who gave idols a wide berth, Paul wanted to make sure they were able to be kind to one another, to honor one another's consciences. But being Paul, he said a little roughly. He says, in effect, "You scrupulous people, don't you know those idols have no power over you? Good for you. Good for you for missing them. You scrupulous people, you're foolish to think otherwise. You need to recommit your trust in God, the only true God, creator of all that is seen and unseen, creator even of the things that make up those idols. Don't judge your siblings in Christ, for it is the Lord alone who judges. What they do is between them and God, and don't you forget it." And then Paul continues, "As for you liberated ones, you folk who think, strangely enough, you've done something special by eating idol meat. Yeah, sure, you got it right. Good for you. Aren't you smart? Aren't you liberated? You glimpsed the truth of God, and you got it spot on. Good for you. But don't make fools of yourself, having stepped forward rightly. Don't fall on your face or break your head. Don't make a fool of yourselves. Don't despise the scrupulous. Don't live in this way, in such a way that your conscience can't handle it. Live instead liberated lives with good intentions. You see, when I discovered Christian liberty, it was the best thing I'd ever known. And I'd hate..."
Grace and peace to you. As it turns out, my camera can't hold quite as much information as I thought it could. So I'm going to finish my sermon here at the parsonage. Don't despise the scrupulous. Don't live in this new way, in such a way that their consciences can't handle it. Live liberated lives with good intentions. When I discovered Christian liberty, it was the best thing that I had ever known. If you make it libertine, you debase the most excellent of things. Do you hear me? Being right in such a way that you ruin somebody else's ability to love, fear, or trust God is always wrong. If your liberation means you no longer love your fellow Christians, then it's not really liberation. I wonder, what would our life together here at St. Stephen be like if we regarded other people's idols in this same way? If we looked at our own scruples as small things? If we recognized that our liberty is tied to the conscience of our siblings in Christ? I imagine it would lead us to realize our scruples around right actions are often acts of self-righteousness, an idol in the face of the righteousness we have in Christ. I imagine it would lead us to unmask what we pass off as Christian liberty for what it really is, salvation by right thought, an idol in the face of the mind of Christ given to us through the Spirit. I pray that the beginning, the middle, and the end of our relationship together here at St. Stephen is love. For in love we are known by God. Amen and Alleluia.